the bulletin.
When are we doing the lighting? Are you going to move? Right now, you're going to go ahead and start? Okay. Okay.
We light today's candle to remind us that peace is like a light shining in a dark place. We dream God's dream, a world of peace, at peace.
Jesus is the Prince of Peace.
Where enemies are reconciled and children play in safety.
Jesus is the Prince of Peace.
Where the poor and powerless find justice.
Jesus is the Prince of Peace.
Where we all find the courage to open our hearts to God.
Jesus is the Prince of Peace.
Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Lord Jesus, in you, God's purpose is revealed. Help us to see your plan for our lives. Give us guidance and direction as we reflect upon your written word and its meaning for us today. May our words and actions glorify and reflect the faith that we have in you. Amen.
Thank you. During this season where so many people feel overly stressed We ask that you help us remain focused on you. As it says in Isaiah 26:3, you will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. During the season of Advent, help us remember and feel that all is calm, and help us keep peace in our hearts. Lord, we also ask you to help us be thoughtful and considerate of others, especially during this season, but also all year long. Help us to show other people your love and the joy and peace that comes from knowing and loving and serving you. During this season when we celebrate you giving your precious Son to the world, help us give back by introducing others to you and showing them your light through us. In your Son's precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you that we have been washed in the blood clothed in your own righteousness by grace through faith. We praise your name forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen.
Heaven shared the sacred meal, and we have recited the Lord's Prayer. Let us give our offerings of our talents, taste, and gifts in support of God's Holy Church.
Thank you. Before I read the scripture, there is something I forgot to attend to earlier. If we do have any first-time visitors, we ask you to look in the bulletin, and there's a sheet that you can pull out, tear off, and fill it out, and let us know if you want a visit from someone or someone to talk to about joining this church. All right, the scripture is from Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. May God add to our understanding of these portions of Holy Scripture.
If you bow your head for a moment of prayer. God, we are so grateful for your word. We are grateful that it corrects. We are grateful that it convicts. And we are so grateful that it comforts. Now, God, we speak your word to comfort in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good morning. Glad you're here. We read Philippians 4, 6, and 7 in the New International Version. I want to read it to you in a couple of other versions. I just want you to hear it in different versions. The New Living Translation says, "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your heart and minds as you live in Christ Jesus." The Message Translation. Don't fret or worry. Instead of worrying, pray. Let petitions and praise shape your worries into prayers, letting God know your concerns. Before you know it, a sense of God's wholeness, everything coming together for good, will come and settle you down. Don't you just love the Message Translation? It'll come and just settle you down. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. So you have heard that in three different versions. And God's title this morning is Purposed for Peace. Purposed for peace. As we continue our Advent season and our series, Waiting for the Gift, we are still learning how to wait. Because as we discovered last week, we don't always wait well. Do you remember that? We don't always wait well. So last week we discussed hope as we wait. Our focus this week is peace as we wait. So today we lit the candle representing peace, but I wonder if we have really received the peace that God offers us, or if we have really received the peace that Christ brings to us. See, our Isaiah text from last week named the coming Messiah as the Prince of Peace, which means Christ was purposed for our peace. Another text in Isaiah that Cindy actually prayed this morning, it says that God will keep in perfect peace anyone whose mind stays on him, which means that we are also purposed for peace. So God offers peace. God promises peace. For God so loved the world that God gave the gift of God's Son for peace. And yet, we are worried. We are worried that our past may come back to haunt us. We are worried that we're not doing enough in our present. We're worried about not having enough in the future. There's a quote that says 97% of the things you worry about never even happen. And yet, we worry anyway. There's a parable that I was reading this past week that I found this past week, and it's called The Parable of Death. It says, death was walking toward a man who stopped him and asked, "What are you going to do?" So the man stopped death and said, "Wait, what are you going to do?" Death said, "I am going to kill 10,000 people. The man said, "That's horrible." Death said, "Well, that's the way it is. That's what I do." As the day passed, the man tried to warn everybody. He went into the hillside. He went to the city. He went to the country. He was warning everybody about death's plan. And at the end of the day, he was frustrated. He came back and he met with death again. He said, "You said you were going to kill 10,000 people, and yet 100,000 people died." Death explained, "Yeah, well, I only killed 10,000. Worry and fear killed the others. So as he went to try to help and he went to tell everyone, they worried and they feared, and worry and fear killed the others. Worry is one of the biggest problems that we face in our lives. It tends to get worse, actually, as we get older. The destruction is for sure. Charles Mayo of the Mayo Clinic said that worry affects our circulation, it affects our heart, it affects our glands, it affects our nervous system, it profoundly affects our whole life. And Connie Bloom, even she knew the destructive force of worry. She said, worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow. Worry empties today of its strength. Its destruction starts like a trickle through our minds, and then it cuts out a furrow until it becomes a Grand Canyon, and all the other thoughts that we have are pulled into the Grand Canyon of worry. But the first line of our text today said, do not be anxious. Do not be anxious. It's a negative command with a positive thrust. See, some scholars believe that this command, which is based on the idea that anxiety, which is from the word merimna, anxiety discloses a lack of trust in God. And it's a type of unconscious blasphemy against God. So this command in our text keeps us from doing the very thing that we need to do, and it causes us to fall away from our faith. It causes us to dwell in our fear, because you have been purposed for peace. God knows what you're facing. God knows what happened. God knows what's coming. And still, the Bible says, do not be anxious. See, anxiety is a leading cause in mental disorders, and it's defined as a feeling of uncertainty, a feeling of worry or nervousness, typically about something that is coming. Anxiety will cause you to get involved in situations that you have no business getting involved in, and then it'll cause you to stay longer in the same situations that you should have stayed. Anxiety causes you to make quick decisions that make extensive damage, and they take triple the time to undo. All because you were anxious and you did not wait well. Anxiety is a part of life, but God offers us peace. God says, do not be anxious. Instead, pray. And now for today's pop quiz. But don't worry, I'll give you the answer. Just pretend. You can raise your hand. It doesn't even matter. I'll give you the answer. What was the first step in waiting well? It was to pray. What did we learn from Nehemiah about a reset? We learned to watch and pray. And now in this text, how do we move from being anxious to having peace? We pray. Do you see a pattern in that? Prayer is the first step. Prayer is the first part of the answer. The New Living Translation said, tell God what you need and thank God for what God has done. The Message translation said, your petitions and your prayers, let them shape your worries into prayers. You have the power to shape your worry into prayers. Tell God what you need and then thank God for what God has done. Petition and then praise. So it's teaching us that prayer and praise complement each other. Prayer and praise, they go together. There's an old adage that we would say that when you think, T-H-I-N-K, then you should thank, T-H-A-N-K. When you think, you should thank. When you think, you should thank. See, anxiousness simply happens when you overthink about something that you don't have control over. I know some of us are dealing with the anxiety of the holidays. Some of us are dealing with the anxiety of sickness. Some of us are dealing with the anxiety of finances or the lack thereof. But according to this text, to achieve peace is not to magically shift from anxiety to peace, but it's a progression from anxiety to prayer, to praise. When you think, then you thank. See, the recalling of God's goodness and the remembering of God's mercy will save us from the many pitfalls which await us if we have an ungrateful soul. When you have an ungrateful soul, a pitfall like the first pitfall is being overly concerned with our immediate problems. See, when we get wrapped up in issues of today, we forget the bigger picture. Then that's when our microwave mentality begins to kick in and we don't leave space for God to do God's work. We are overly concerned with immediate problems. The second thing is when we have an ungrateful soul, forgetfulness, we forget God's gracious dealings with us in the past. We forget how much grace God extended to us. We think that we have what we have, or we survived what we survived because of our own doing and not because of God's grace. Oh, but if it had not been for the Lord on your side, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, if it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would we be? The third thing, it causes us to disregard the needs of people who are less fortunate than we are. When we experience this pitfall of an ungrateful soul, we start believing that people ought to just pull themselves up from their own bootstraps. We forget that someone at some point helped us to pull ourselves up. We forget that someone gave us the help that we needed. We cannot disregard the less fortunate and oppose the thoughts when we remember to think and we remember to thank. When you think, thank. So now, let's try it together. I may not have everything I need. I may not have everything I want, but I have everything I need. Someone say, thank you, Lord. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that God has brought me through, my soul cries out, hallelujah. Someone say, hallelujah. See, we must shift from anxiety to prayer to praise. If you're going to worry, don't pray. If you're going to pray, don't worry. Because God gives us peace. So we shift from anxiety to prayer to praise, and then there's another shift. See, once you begin to shape your worries into your prayers, after you give it over to God, after you praise God for the positive results, even though you may have had a negative thought, something happens. See, whenever you're reading scripture, you can tell when something is about to happen by the transition that's used. When I read today, when we read NIV, it said, and. When I read New Living Translation, it said, then. The Message Translation said, before you know it. See, it means that something is about to happen, because when you shape your worry into prayer, you offer your worry to God with praise and a grateful heart, something happens. Well, not just something happens, peace happens. What kind of peace? A peace that transcends all understanding, one that surpasses our understanding. I don't even understand why I'm not anxious anymore. I don't understand why I'm not worried anymore. I don't understand why I'm not angry anymore. That, my friends, is the peace of God. That is evidence of divine peace. When the things that used to bother you don't bother you anymore, that's a sign of God's peace. When the people that used to bother you don't bother you anymore, that is a sign of God's peace. When those old triggers or those old buttons that people used to push and you would fly off the wall, you remember those? Because I know you're so holy, you don't do that now. You would fly off the handle, you'd use those four-letter words that aren't found in the Bible, but some of us are, you know, a little bit better. You use four and five and six-letter words, but when those words don't come as quickly as they used to, that, my friend, is God's peace. And this peace transcends your understanding. When this peace comes, you won't understand why the old buttons don't work anymore. Have you ever walked away from a situation or you're in the middle of a situation, you're like, you know what? I remember back in the day, I would have laid him out for that. Or a few years ago, that might have really hurt my feelings. Or last week, that would have broken my spirit. But see, God's peace has not just overtaken you, it has risen above your understanding. You don't even know why you don't act the way you used to act. That is God's peace. See, your friends and your family are waiting on you to fall apart. They know you lost your job. They know your marriage is ending. They know your business is struggling. They know that sickness has come to your home or sickness has come to your body, and they are watching and waiting for you to break down, and it never happens. Sometimes you are waiting for you to break down, and it never happens. That's when you know God has stepped in and God has given you peace. See, people are waiting for you to break down, and instead you experience a breakthrough. And I pray right now that God's peace will shift somebody today, that God's peace will shift somebody this morning from the spirit of breakdown to the power of a breakthrough. That deserves a thank you, Lord. That deserves a thank you, Lord. Okay, I just wondered if you were still with me. Okay. Now, allow me to point out something here. Let me point this out. The text says that we take our requests, we take our petitions to God, and we take our issues, we take our problems, but it didn't say that God would work it out. It didn't say that God would give us the answer. It didn't say that, you know, you take it to God and everything will be all right. Now, it may say that somewhere in the Bible, but that's not where we read in our text. That's not what it said. Here it says, take God your concerns and God will give you peace. God will make a great exchange with you. God will trade your sorrow for peace. God will trade your hurt for peace. God will trade your confusion for peace. It didn't say I'll stop the storm, but if you'll come to me, I can give you peace in the middle of the storm. And that's good news. Even if it doesn't work out today, I can keep pressing forward because I know that I'll have peace about it. The peace is so good, I don't even understand it. I don't understand where I don't understand how I got it. I don't understand how, but I can definitely tell you who gave me the peace. Finally, the text says, this same peace will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. Guard in this context is from a Greek military term, implying that it's giving the picture that peace is standing on duty to keep away anything that could bring you concern or anxiety. Like soldiers are assigned to watch over a certain area, God's peace is assigned to protect your heart, and God's peace is assigned to protect your mind. His peace is designed to protect your emotions and your thoughts. Because it's our emotions and our thoughts that keep us from waiting well. Lindenwood, my heart's desire is that you will have peace. That the turmoil of the transitions in the past don't push you to make anxious decisions in the present. God has God's hands on Lindenwood Christian Church. And you can rest in God's plan. Your future is a part of God's plan. Don't be anxious in the process. God's promise will come to pass. It will come to pass for the church, and it will come to pass for you. In this season of waiting on the Prince of Peace, the one who will bring eternal peace to the world, God still offers God's divine peace just for you. We are expecting the peace on earth and goodwill toward men, but there is a song that says, let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me. I pray that you begin to give peace more. I pray that you'll begin to receive peace more. Sometimes waiting causes anxiousness, but I speak peace will begin with you. I speak that God's peace will guard your heart. I speak that God's peace will guard your mind. I speak that God's peace will heal your past. I speak that God's peace will transcend your present. I speak that God's peace will manifest in your future. I speak that God's peace will dry your tears. I speak that God's peace will push you past your fears. I speak that God's peace will comfort you when you wait well. I speak that God's peace will comfort you and you'll know that God never fails. I speak that the Prince of Peace will grant you the promise of peace today, tomorrow, and forevermore. You are purposed for peace, and it is so in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. You are purposed for peace. Because God gave us the gift of God's Son, the Prince of Peace, we always want to take a moment to offer you Christ in our worship experience. We never know, there may be someone who has not accepted Christ as their Savior. So if you're able, I ask you to stand with me as we offer Christ. If you decide that this is the day that you want to accept Christ, if you'll come forward and give me your hand and give God your heart. If you'll remain standing for our choral benediction. You are purpose for peace. I pray that this week you will give more peace and you will receive more peace. And it is so. In Jesus' name, amen.